facilitate the best such platforms as we build together. Now, the whole reason of doing Astro is such that we feed off of those synergies. The technology comes after, and it solves the needs on the...
Customers just need to feel safe. They really, it is of crucial importance that they feel safe with you.
DTBX, what we're trying to say, who is a part of the bank that is going to be focused on digital technology and innovation? We want to partner with people so that we can co-create and bring products to market as quickly as we possibly can. Astro is what we call our banking as a service proposition. So it's built on top of an API platform. This allows us to extend discrete components of financial services so those fintechs and other tech companies can take advantage of those to offer them to their customers.
How would we be able to take on the ideal scenario that here's embedded finance that we want to take out to the market? There's a whole cross-section of industry. Constantly reminded, we want to play in public sector, we want to play in agriculture, we want to play in healthcare, want to play in education, but if I have a partner in the room that knows how the inner workings of such an industry works, value exchange, which is what would underpin most of the conversations that happen within that industry, can be facilitated by such platforms as we build together. Now, the whole reason of doing Astro is such that we feed off of those synergies. The technology comes after, and it solves the needs on the problems that we can actually take to market.
Today, and I'm told it's particularly special because you are electing a new chair. But anyway, I hope you still get the chance to just garner your, you know, to reap your love dividends after this event. But thank you all again for joining us today. We do not take it for granted. We have a wonderful program lined up for you. We're hoping it will be informative. You'll get some good insight and inspirations from the same. So maybe since it's Valentine, please just turn to the person next to you and say something positive. Not necessarily about Valentine's. Yeah, they might not be the perfect candidate for whatever you have in mind. Or at least you'll get in trouble. Thank you. It's really good to see the love and the laughter in the room. Our own chairman thinks he might buy for the position. He's very excited. Chairman, are you a candidate this year? Are you a candidate for the men's conference chairmanship? All right, thanks again. Please, at this moment, allow me to invite our key host, our MD, Ms. Hasim Adebde. And since it's Valentine and she's really dressed for it, let's show her some love. Hasim. And even as she comes, the word is lying here outside. If you are uncomfortable using with your photo being used for anything to do with this event, please pick one so we don't do it without your consent. Nasim, karibu sana.
Are we all good?
Yes.
Breakfast? Yes? Okay. Sorry for the late start, but we'll try and catch up with the time, PS. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. The Principal Secretary, State Department for Investment Promotion, Ministry of Investment, Trade and Industry, Mr. Abubakar Hassan Abubakar. DTB Board Chairman, Linus Githai, board members present, distinguished speakers, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning. Good morning and welcome to the third DGB Economic and Sustainability Forum, our thought leadership platform that brings together the government, private sector, and other key stakeholders to discuss issues of mutual interest with the aim of unlocking prosperity for all of us. And what better day to come together than on Valentine's Day? A day traditionally dedicated to celebrating love and meaningful connections. As some indulge in heart-shaped chocolates, sharing of red roses, and other niceties, we gather here to nurture a different kind of love, a deeper connection brought about by our shared aspirations and collective commitment to building a more resilient and sustainable future. On this note, allow me to wish you all a happy Valentine's Day. Indeed, I do feel a sense of warmth and love in the air, which I believe forms the perfect backdrop for the discussions ahead. Before I proceed, P.S. Abubakar, thank you so much for joining us this morning. Your presence here today is a welcome show of support by the government in partnering with us, the private sector, towards the aspiration and shared prosperity. Your leadership in rebuilding confidence is very timely. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me a moment to introduce and appreciate the DTB board members joining us today. Chairman Linus Githai, he's become a stronger supporter of this platform, and he will be moderating our panel discussions today. Director Pamela Agar, Director Irfan Khashoggi, Director Jeremy Gunze, Director Ismail Mauji, and our Finance and Strategy Director, Al-Karim Jiva. I thank you all for your support. The theme of our forum today, business reinvention in times of economic uncertainty and climate change, is not a new concept, but has become a timeless imperative for business. Today, as an economy, we face uncertainty of radical proportions, from pandemics to geopolitical fluidity to climate extremes to rapid policy changes, all with unprecedented economic and financial ramifications for governments, businesses, and households. Even then, it is my belief that as an economy, we do have the capacity and perseverance to not only survive, but thrive in this new reality of uncertainty. Indeed, despite the challenges of 2023, the economy is estimated to have grown by 5.5% in 2023, a decent shot above the sub-Saharan Africa and global averages. In 2024, we are more optimistic that the economic landscape will continue to evolve more favorably. And signs are already evident that we are turning around. Investor sentiment is reversed remarkably. Just this week, the government was able to successfully float a $1.5 billion note, which garnered over $5 billion, in fact, almost $6 billion in bids. Furthermore, efforts by the central bank to streamline forex markets are also helping to stabilize the exchange rate. And inflation should moderate, allowing the CBK to begin reducing interest rates later this year. As a result, we do expect the economy to grow by 5.56% in 2024, driven not only by agriculture, but also recovering in the real sector, especially in the latter half of the year. But I will leave the details and the questions on the same to Faith, our expert in this field. I may sound more optimistic than some of you today. However, I'm reminded that one of the objectives of this engagement is to ensure we do not lose sight of the bigger picture, the opportunities that this country continues to present even in the face of uncertainty. And today, I believe the glass is more than half full. If there is one thing I've learned from the economic and business cycles of my time, is the need to embrace change and reinvent oneself to remain relevant and competitive. Reinvention is not only about ideation and innovation, it also involves restructuring our operations, processes, and business models. We therefore must identify and address inefficiencies and streamline our processes to be agile and resilient. As DTB, we are relooking at our business operations, where automation could enhance efficiencies, where leveraging technology can improve our customer experience, and where sustainable practices could reduce our operating costs. To this end, I am proud to announce that DTB Center, our head office, has been certified EDGE Advanced, which is excellence in design for greater efficiencies. A green building certification system developed by the International Finance Corporation, IFC. This is because we have saved 62% on energy, 30% on water, and 99% on less embodied carbon materials. Amrish Shah, see you somewhere. Hi, Amrish. Amrish Shah from Urban Green Consultants will speak more on this later. I am certain that our discussions and learnings here today will inspire us to continue embracing change as an opportunity for growth and transformation, rising beyond the challenges to rewrite our narrative and redefine the future. Together, we can navigate these times and emerge as a stronger, more resilient, and sustainable economy. And I look forward to learning from
speakers on some of the emerging opportunities, how they are pivoting their businesses to embrace the rapid changes, and how we can reinvent ourselves for sustained growth. Thank you once again for joining us this morning. I look forward to the discussions. Now, allow me to welcome back Faith Atiti, DTB's head of research, to reinforce my remarks on the economy.
Thank you very much, Nassim. You've made my work as easy and as difficult as it can get. I think you pretty much summarized everything so well. And now I stand here afraid of repeating yourself, but certainly I'll try to underscore your remarks, at least from statistics perspective. So we have a few slides up. Even as they bring that up, remember to tag us on our X handle, formerly Twitter, at _DTB Kenya. You got that up? Thank you. So as Nassim mentioned, our economy remains quite resilient. Yes, indeed. The last few years, we've been subjected to quite some extreme shocks. But even then, overall growth has remained well near the historical average, and of course, overshooting or performing way better than our sub-Saharan African peers and even the global average. So Kenya continues to present a remarkable opportunity from that perspective. Yes, we are not immune to the realms that characterize business cycle, but what is clear is we go through them and emerge back quite successfully. And we don't think this season will be different. As Nassim well mentioned, and I really don't want to repeat that, if you can just go to the next slide. As Nassim well mentioned, sentiment is really turned over the last couple of days. And we know much of the shocks that we did experience last year were a result of the fear that surrounded how government manages, you know, the 2024 Eurobond. And now that that uncertainty has been lifted, we see a lot of confidence coming up, which is very critical for investors into 2024 and beyond. So we are confident, yes, we will gradually recover from, of course, the shocks that we experienced then. Evidence is very clear with the issue of the $1.5 billion Eurobond. We've seen markets begin to correct. Those who've been buying dollars from the market, you can confirm today you're getting a whole lot more favorable rates for the same. So we're seeing some stability on the exchange rate, and of course those are the initial signals that indeed sentiment is turning around. And as the exchange rate stabilizes, we do expect equally inflation to come down. According to Central Bank, they do estimate that about 40% of the inflation that has been reported over the last couple of months has been a result of foreign exchange pass-through. So as some of these shocks dissipate, we do expect also inflation to come down. And of course, part of the reason why we've seen a sharp rise, at least interest rates going up from the both central bank and markets generally, it's partly because inflation has been high. And you can see the ripple effect of that. Once the exchange rate stabilizes, inflation should come down, and that gives the central bank headroom to begin reducing interest rates in coming months. And we do expect at least mid-year and beyond, we should begin to see now interest rates equally coming down. And of course, that's very critical for resumption of investments as well as consumption, which of course underpins a lot of business in the sectors most of us here today play in. So yes, I do support Nassim's optimism that 2024 will indeed be a good year, and of and the sheer fact that we are now able to access external markets means that yes, we could also see government spending, and hopefully the PS speaks to that, start to pick up compared to what we've seen over the last couple of days. And of course, with the stability on the exchange rate, also the debt service costs might stabilize. Of course, the noise therein should also dissipate. Like I mentioned, the next slide, inflation is expected to come down pretty much because of course the stability we're seeing on the exchange rate, and I say 40% of what the pressures we're feeling today are related to the exchange rate depreciation. But beyond that, I think we've had a good season of rains, which gives us some stability on the food side. The central bank has also been very active, very proactive in managing exchange, rather the inflation expectations by raising interest rates. And we expect to see a much slowdown as a result of that on the inflation front. But also the fact that we are coming from a very high base means we will see that inflation trend go down, which is a welcome direction for all of us. But of course, we keep watching out for any shocks. This will take time of this, the residual effects of the exchange rate depreciation. We'll still expect to feel that over the next couple of months. As things normalize, of course, we do expect government, in line with their fiscal consolidation plan or efforts to stabilize debt, reverse some of the subsidies, especially around fuel, and that could also keep some pressure therein. But also we are subject to volatile, of course, energy markets. If the OPEC decides today we are going to cut production further, or the global economy picks up and demand shoots up, then you could also see some pressure therein. But I think we are encouraged by the sheer fact that on the food side we are looking more favorable, and also the exchange side is stabilizing, so the shocks therein should be a lot more moderate. And like I mentioned, as inflation decline, we do expect now the central bank to equally respond by pushing rates down. Certainly, we continue to monitor developments on the debt side. It's been rather favorable over the last couple of weeks, rather months, and not just because we are now able to reaccess market, but there's also some commitment on the government side to just bring down fiscal deficit and slow down the rate at which we do accumulate debt. And of course, the inflation on the debt side has also been largely a result of the exchange rate movement. And as that also stabilizes, then we also expect it to have a positive knock-on effect on the overall debt position. So, and as of course, tax collection remains a big question at this point, but if indeed the optimism crystallizes, then we also expect at least some pickup therein, or debt service costs to equally reduce, if not stabilize. I think this year was an outlier because of that 2 billion euro bond, but I think subsequent years, until I think 2028, we do expect the pressure therein to be much less. And what's also encouraging is just the turn in expectation or sentiment across global markets. We've seen a lot of appetite return for emerging and frontier markets. Those who follow markets, you be aware that the last couple of few weeks we've seen Ivory Coast, Benin go to market issuing Eurobonds at very good prices. And I think it's opening up space. And even locally today, we're seeing a lot of interest in our own bonds coming through. I think we're gonna have, we're likely to see a record subscription for the infrastructure bond that is on offer today. Government is looking for 70 billion, but we think they may well over get over 200 billion as this sentiment indeed strengthen. So it's a whole positive narrative. There's portfolio flows now beginning to come back to our market. This investor sentiment is also turning, at least from a market perspective. And I think as that filter through, then we expect that to also get to the real economy. But what's also encouraging is as we reaccess external market, as these flows begin to come back, we also expect that the government appetite for local debt will begin to slow down, you know, bringing back some liquidity within the market, which I believe our businesses need quite urgently. And then finally, on the exchange rate side, the foreign currency, the foreign exchange, we've seen very positive developments on the shilling. Coming January was extremely fluid. I think many people are caught off guard with the sharp depreciation on the exchange rate, but that has since reversed. The distortions we've seen in the markets before have now been streamlined, so we don't have two markets as we may have experienced before. But what's also encouraging is that supply is coming back, because the biggest challenge, I think, for many of us in the room was not the pricing, but just the availability of the dollars in the market. And I think that is beginning now to correct. So fundamentally, I think we're looking a whole lot better. Our current account is not going down as much. Rather, it's stabilizing at around 4% of GDP. We have, like I said, interest rates are now drawing some portfolio flows into the market. The uncertainty around the Eurobond is now being lifted. And of course, we expect now the foreign exchange reserves to stabilize and pick up, at least improve over the next couple of weeks. And just, yes, that global narrative is also now favoring emerging and frontier markets, and I think Kenya is well positioned to ride that going forward. So all said, of course, we will keep looking out for any developments around weather that could change that narrative, how fast and prudent the fiscal consolidation or the fiscal side evolves. Of course, many in the room would appreciate our exports have also slowed. So structurally, it's something as a country we need to address if, of course, some of these exchange rate issues are to be sustainably addressed. How we relate to the region is also critical, because it's their key markets, but they are equally competitors. So we can gain by you know, diversifying more and doing more business with them, but they can also take investments from us if we do not remain competitive enough. But overall, I think as a country, we do have the base that we need to still thrive as a business, as well as Nassim well put in her remarks. Of course, the external side is also evolving, like I said, a lot more favorably than in 2023. Yes, the economies were slow, but as central banks sort of near peak interest rates and talk of reversing interest rates, we do expect one, demand to also start picking up. Secondly, the appetite we've seen for dollar globally to also moderate, bringing some flow back to our side. But we also watch out for, you know, the fluidity that's brought about by the geopolitics of the day. And of course, given this is a sustainability, economic and sustainability question, we look at the developments around sustainability, whether it's on regulation, how the funds are flowing. I think as a nation, we stand to gain a lot from that. So allow me to end my presentation at that. I think, Nassim, you summarized it very well. We are very optimistic into 2024. We probably would not have said the same 2 months ago, but yes, the beauty is one sentiment turn. There's a lot that does ride on that. So thank you very much. At this point, do allow me to invite our chairman, Mr. Linus Gitahi, who will also be introducing our keynote speaker. Thank you. He's also our moderator for today, so it's really an honor that you really took this up. Thanks.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Muko salama. First of all, there is no way that I'm going to wear a Valentine tie halafu nikae nyuma ya hii bao. How do you get to see that there is a Valentine tie, right? And it's 14th, right? Yeah, I think you need to make a speech again, but now starting here, Nassim. So today I am not going to make a speech. As you can see, what we do around here is what Nassim says, and Nassim says today I'm moderating. So I'll be moderating, and therefore I'll not be making a speech. But just to say, first of all, our chief guest, Bwana Abubakar Hassan Abubakar, we are really, really happy to see you. We are really happy to have you here today. It's actually an honor that you agreed to come. We have had several engagements with the peers at the Kenya Association of Manufacturers. And I don't think the industry, the business would have wished for a better peers, because he's really, really focused in terms of what we need to do, in terms of what we need to transform industry, to transform the business environment. And most importantly, he has a listening ear and is always available for us. In fact, we are chatting a little earlier, and even Flora was saying, I agree with you, Linus. So, karibu sana. And we look forward to our engagement. Then today, ladies and gentlemen, we have great people. All of us are great. But today, let me tell you, we have two people who have traversed the business environment. The first one is Jazz Bedi. This gentleman, Jazz Bedi, has been for many years the chairman of Kenya Association of Manufacturers, that the apex body for manufacturers. And he did that, he did very well. Then he was pulled by KEPSA, which is the umbrella body for all of us. And then KEPSA said, we saw what you did in KEM, tafadhali kuja ukue chairman. So he's now the current chairman of KEPSA. And as if that is not enough, we also had the chair of KEM, I think the first lady chair of KEM, Frola Mutahi, here. And Frola also did an excellent job for KEM. And then KEPSA did the same. They said, Frola, we saw what you did at KEM, kuja. So she was also the immediate past chair of KEPSA. So we have, if you have people who've been chair of KEM and chair of KEPSA, and you're talking about business, I don't think you could have wished for a better team to come here and we have the conversation. And then we've got our friend who is, and we are a member of the Institute of Economic Affairs. We've got Kwame. Kwame here. I think you see Kwame talking about the economy. For me, one of the most gifted economists that we have in this country, somebody who is also very accessible, somebody we talk to when we want to understand these things. In fact, Faith, I hope you have checked, you've had a one-on-one with Kwame, otherwise he may disagree with your data. but I hope you had a one-on-one. But it is a good conversation because we, as a people, as Diamond Trust Bank, we want to do the best, we want to be transparent, we want to have the right conversations. And you saw, even from our CEO, where we are today, we are actually very optimistic. I am very optimistic that we are beginning to turn the tide. And hopefully, towards the end of the year and into next year, we are going to have a much better environment for business. And a much better environment for business means a much better environment for you and for Kenyans in general. So today we have two groups of people. We have our customers, and customers, we salute you. If you are a customer, please wave at me. If you are a customer, asante sana kwa kuja. We'll always look forward to working together. We hope that, Nasim, you're also a customer, right? We also look forward to working with you and ensuring that we meet your needs, your business needs, and the other needs. The other group of people we have here is our friends. So friends, karibuni sana. I think by now you have seen we are not bad boys and girls. And so let us see how, by the time we now have the next meeting, that we can be customers, because we'll continue to invite friends, but we hope that after we have engaged and you have seen who we are, then we can also shift to the side of sustainability. I didn't know sustainability from a friend's point of view is when you become a customer. And talking of sustainability, ladies and gentlemen, I think this is a topic from where I sit that is long overdue. And I'm glad, very happy, that DTB has now made it a central pillar of our conversations with our customers. Because when you really think about it, the conversation about sustainability is actually not a business conversation. The conversation about sustainability is our way of life. It is a conversation about you and me and how we live. It is indeed, when you think about it, a conversation about our values. Because when if I may use an analogy that has been talked about, particularly in the political circles, I think in the last couple of year or two, people have been talking about who is a shareholder of what in the political circles. But I want to say here, I think we are all shareholders or stakeholders for Mother Earth. And being stakeholders in Mother Earth, what we do as individuals, what we do as corporates, what we do within the ecosystem that we operate in, is really what influences the kind of treatment and the kind of outcome that we see in Mother Earth. It is easy for us to complain about climate change. It is easy for us to complain about many, many other things. But the question is, what are we doing at the individual level? Because sustainability is not a conversation we will have because we have a corporate meeting. It is a question of what are you doing as an individual? Yes, you have that little chamber. Is it about, and I know obviously you probably have cut a tree or two, but have you planted many so that you, no, forget about everybody else, so that your children, when they look back at that piece of land, they say, Mom, actually, you see that little forest? Or you see those number of trees? I remember me and Mom, or me and Dad, walking around and digging holes and planting. It is not just about solar. It is about the things we do moment by moment as individuals to ensure that we actually hand over a better environment to the next generation. It's only that now when we bring it to another level, we are talking about it at the corporate level. But I think the challenge is for us to say, me as an individual, this is what I'm doing to ensure that this environment, the place that I'm privileged to either serve or be, will be left better because I lived. And actually, to be honest, Adam, that is, you know, DTB is part of the AKDN network. And AKDN network is an institution that has actually committed itself to ensure that we have we are carbon neutral by the year 2030. And we will be working as much as we can to ensure that that happens. So in a sense, then you're not surprised that you can see DTB winning a couple of prizes on that front, and I'm sure the other institutions too are winning prizes left, right, and center, because it is core to what we do. It is not about the profit you make, it's about how you make that profit. It is not just about the number, it's about whether it is sustainable. It is also about the government creating that environment that ensures that we create employment. Because, you know, when you talk about sustainability, it's not about just solar and trees. It is about that brother, that sister in the rural areas or who has finished university and wants, obviously, to have a job and wants to have a job that you can that can provide income for many years to come. And the way you do that is to ensure that, for instance, in the private sector, that we create the jobs. How you create the jobs is by ensuring that even the government creates an environment that ensures that the private sector can create the jobs, a favorable environment where you not only create the jobs, but you create sustainable jobs that you can say people work 20, 30 years and change as the environment changes. That creates sustainability for those individuals. It creates sustainability for the people who would be doing those jobs, and even for the organization to come from one generation to another generation. And we've seen, especially in the developed world, organizations that are in the 10th, 15th, 20th generation in terms of that is sustainability. And we must really look at what we need to do, like I said, at the individual level to ensure that we create that sustainability. Na kama nilivyosema, mimi sikuwa na speech. Akira was asked to come here right now to invite our chief guest to give some remarks. So Bwana Abubakar, karibu sana. Tunataka tumpigie makofi ya namna gani? Yo. And I am also happy to say, as he comes, I don't know whether it was a DTB making, but he is the only man who got a flower from DTB. I don't know whether it's because of Valentine or whether it's because he was a chief guest, but whatever the case, I can see something you treasure. Nasema karibu sana na ogea na hii watu yako. Hii watu yote ni yako. Asante.
Thank you very much, Chairman. And for clarity, I also have a red tie. You know, I came on stage with this flower because in that reserved table, there was only one flower, and it was strategically positioned facing my chair. But it reminded me when I was young, and I was a bit shy. I believe I'm still shy to approach ladies. And I was also a real hustler. I could not afford to buy a flower to give to a lady during Valentine. So I was given a pickup line by some friends, and I crammed it up to now. So when I approach a lady, I used to tell them, a rose is just but a shade of red compared to you. And the rest is history. And now guys are coming for tips on how to approach ladies. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Linus Gitahi, Chairman, Board of Diamond Trust, and other board members present. Mrs. Naseem Devji, the Managing Director of Diamond Trust Bank, and my former boss. I used to work at Central Bank, and then I was seconded to Kenya Development Corporation, where she was my board member. She was the chair of audit committee, and I can confirm she's really tough in terms of effectiveness, efficiency, and integrity. Jas Bedi, the chair of KEPSA and KEPROBA, a true example of a PPP, because he's chair of a government agency and our ministry called KEPROBA, and he's also chair of Kenya Private Sector Alliance. Distinguished guests and speakers, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I'm honored to be joining you today on behalf of the Cabinet Secretary for Investment, Trade and Industry, Honorable Rebecca Miano. She would have loved to be part of this engagement, but had to attend to other official matters. Let me also take this opportunity to thank the board, the staff, and the management of Diamond Trust Bank for this noble idea of taking stock of the current economic status to determine the opportunities that lay therein and redefining our future. This administration recognizes the role of private sector in the economic development of this country. And we are committed and determined to come up to pursue policies that are pro-private sector development, and pro-private sector investment-led economic growth. We acknowledge that private investment is a function of many variables, and two of the main variables is the economic environment and climate change. Therefore, the theme of this forum, Business Reinvention in the Era of Economic Uncertainty and Climate Change, is not only timely but relevant for not only businesses but for the government as well. And I look forward to getting some insights from this engagement that could also elevate our operation as a ministry and government. Our goal as government is to have a quality economic growth, which is mambo ni matatu, economic growth which is resilient, economic growth which is sustainable, and economic growth which is inclusive. It is imperative to note that despite the increasingly dynamic landscape, our economy continues to show remarkable resilience, presenting opportunities for investors across the sectors. The government is relentless in its quest to have strong and stable macroeconomic indicators that will facilitate and encourage investment. To this end, you can see the inflation rate has begun stabilizing and Kenya shilling is beginning to show an upward trend. Just yesterday, the Eurobond was oversubscribed 4 times, demonstrating confidence in our economy. As Nassim had put it, we have capacity not only to survive but also to thrive. That's what you said, right? So this can happen if we work together for this common cause. We continuously and consistently engage to navigate through this turbulent environment. The investment landscape of Kenya, the Kenya's economic diversification and liberalization, the Kenyan market size and its green credentials, the Kenyan geostrategic position in the region, the Kenyan demographic dividends, and the Kenyan investment grade opportunities offers good scope not only to attract new investment but to expand existing investments. It is in realization of this competitive advantage that government through our ministry is continuously reviewing the investment climate and business environment. Let me just boast around. The international rankings, Kenya has been ranked 29th fastest economic growing economy. Kenya has been rated the first in Africa in terms of startup funding. Kenya has been rated number one in Africa with the greatest investment momentum in 2024. The ministry, through the State Department for Investment Promotion, is charged with the responsibility of coordinating the transformation of the ecosystem supporting private sector development and development of a business reform agenda action plan across the entirety of government. My State Department is basically a private sector State Department. Its job, its mandate is to link the private sector to the public sector and to promote a coordination of private investment into the Kenyan economy. I was given 5 tools by the Executive Order No. 1 of 2023. The first tool is a Business Reforms and Transformation Unit that sits in my State Department, and its mandate is to continuously engage the private sector to identify impediments to be removed and incentives to be created so that businesses can be competitive and thrive. The second tool I was given is Special Economic Zones. The third tool is export processing zones to help business in reducing their cost of production and make them competitive globally. The fourth tool I was given is a de-risking tool. It is called Kenya Development Cooperation. It helps in de-risking private investment through co-investment debt or equity. At a very, if it is debt, it is less than 10%. I know it will be providing competition to the banking sector, but we provide loans in the industrial space for less than 10%. And we can also co-invest through equity investments. Ladies and gentlemen, towards this end, last year, the Cabinet approved a Business Reform Action Plan Coordinating Committee to be chaired by our Minister, Rebecca Miano, and we have been engaging the private sector continuously to identify cost of business issues. There are 3 focus areas that we are focusing on our Business Reforms and Transformation Unit for this year. Is cost of doing business, which we are engaging all the private sector in Kenya to identify what needs to be reduced, where government intervention is needed, and His Excellency the President will meet the private sector at the end of March so that we have a common position. These are the areas which government needs to intervene to reduce the cost of doing business. 2, it is on the ease of doing business and a Be Ready World Bank program. And 3 is to harmonize, standardize the county licensing manenos. You are aware that there is a problem there with county licensing, inter-county, so we are focusing on that and we have support from the World Bank to do the same. Additionally, this ministry is streamlining procedures for business registration, reducing bureaucratic red tape, and improving the efficiency of government services under the Kenya Invest One Start, One Go Center. It is no longer called one-stop shop because investors, when they come to Kenya, they don't ask where to stop. They ask where to start, right? Then once you start, you just go. So we have renamed it One Start, One Go. It has 20 government agencies sitting in one place to facilitate investors who want to invest in Kenya. The government continues to implement the bottom-up economic transformation agenda for sustained and inclusive growth. This is presenting remarkable opportunities for partnership in agriculture, manufacturing, digital superhighway, and creative economy, housing and settlement, MSME economy, the key pillars of our better strategy. We have 5 key pillars and 10 priority value chains, which includes tea, coffee, rice, dairy, edible oil, building and construction, blue economy, minerals, I think we are 10 now. So all these priority value chain, we have incentivized them to attract investment. And our incentive package in Kenya is threefold. First, we have general incentives. The second, we have specific incentives in our special economic zones and export processing zones. And then we have customized incentives. Our Income Tax Act allows if you bring investment worth 10 billion, we can talk to you and discuss what kind of incentives do you want for your business to thrive. And now we are working on a performance-based incentives. So we give you incentives, but you need to show us if you're going, how many jobs you're going to create, what kind of investment you're going to pull. So we are moving to those kind of incentives. All those incentives are in our Kenya Investment Authority website. You can access them. As a country, we are also championing transitioning to green economy, attracting green investments and finance to fund green opportunities and create green jobs. In the COP28 last year, His Excellency the President announced an Africa Green Industrialization Initiative, which is going to be spearheaded by His Excellency in Kenya. Also, January 2024 this year, the Cabinet has approved the Sovereign Green Bond Framework and also the National Green Initiative, Green Incentive Policy Framework. We are greening our financial system. We are continuing to greening our financial system to allow green financing. You know, when I was in school, then there was a topic on green subjects. Then the lecturer told us there's difference between greening finance and green financing. Are you greening finance is for the governments to green its financial system, to green its transport system. Then green finance is for the private sector to take advantage of the green framework. I don't know if I'm making sense. So greening finance and green financing is different. My State Department has worked with World Bank, and World Bank approved last year for a green investment fund of $40 million. It will be administered by KDC to de-risk private investment in the green space. So you can take advantage of that. We have $40 million. We are doing a roadshow to crowd in another $40 million from other partners. Then we bring it here, and it will help you to de-risk private investment. Our vision is to convert KDC to a sovereign wealth fund. I don't know whether Kwame will agree with that vision. We believe that is a realistic vision. The State Department has also embarked on aggressive investment promotion, both national, regional, and multilateral level, focusing on attracting green investment. Just last week, His Excellency the President, we held a business forum with Japanese investors and Kenyans in the diaspora, and he was able to secure a $100 billion commitment investment in the green value chain. Let me reiterate that as government, we will continue to seek ways to adjust to the emerging uncertainties while maintaining a favorable ecosystem, an environment that balances economic growth with environmental conservation and social development for a more inclusive and sustainable economy. I look forward to the engagements here today for insights on how we can scale our partnership with yourselves, the investors and banks, for a stronger and a sustainable economic growth with sustained prosperity for our people and business. Let me quote Nassim again. I like her positive image and energy, that glass is more than half full. Please don't overestimate the risk and underestimate the opportunity that Kenya possesses. This is the year of converting the investment leads to actual investment deals to support our public investment. I thank you.
Thank you, Bwana PS. What we did not know is that that little flower had a destination. And it has actually reached the destination. I did what in golf we call a head up. One of the guests we had, I hadn't seen that she had arrived. That is Jane Wangari. Jane Wangari is a sustainability and Geocycle Director at Baburi Cement PLC. She's an expert in climate and energy, manenos, circular economy, water, nature, biodiversity, human rights, social initiatives, a sustainable procurement, and green financing. So as we call the team up there to so that we can do the moderating, the conversations with yourselves, I will probably ask Jane to go first. Just make 2 minutes remarks, and then ukimaliza, you choose the seat you want. This is now the advantage of the fact that I had forgotten to acknowledge you. You take the seat that you want after 2 minutes.
The PS Investments, Mr. Bakara, Linus Gitahi, the chairman of DTB Bank, the CEO and MD of DTB Bank, Ms. Nassim, all protocol observed. Good morning, everybody. So as you've heard, my name is Jane Wangari of Mburi Cement, and I'm happy to be here today to have conversations on sustainability, where we talk big words, decarbonization, going green, green financing, yeah, green mobility and such like. And as you can see, our Valentine's, us, the sustainability people, celebrate it in green, as you can see. So, so thank you very much, and I look forward to very positive interactions. Asante.
Thank you very much. I think next, I invite our senior chair here, Jazz Bedi, to just say a few words, and then we'll join Jane over there.
I think I just want to ride a little bit on what Nassim said earlier on, and so did the PS. As Kenya, we have a very, very resilient economy. We've seen it in the last 18 months, and we've seen it prior also during the period of COVID. And I would just like to share a very small story before I sit down. And that story is that during COVID, in the pandemic 2020, we looked at all countries in the world, and every one of them showed declining sales, revenue going down. And when I looked at the export data of Kenya, and all our exports are largely done by air, it's floriculture, horticulture, and I said to myself, oh my God, we're gonna lose at least 20 to 25% of our export revenue. Our average revenue on export is about $6 billion. In 2020, I gave a warning to government and I said, if we cross $4.5 billion, we'll be lucky. And that is because 3 months of no sales, 3 months of no exports, 3 months of no flights leaving Kenya. And that was a very difficult period for Kenya, I thought. But to my total surprise, when we closed the year 2020, Kenya's exports went up by 6.7%. And normally you ask yourself, what went wrong? In this case, I was asking myself, what went right? And when we looked at what went right, and when I did the YY analysis, there was one commodity that carried the day. And that one commodity was tea. Our exports went up by $400 million. And when I said to myself, why did tea go right? What was the reason? And the reason was simple. The whole world was on lockdown. Everybody was sitting at home. And when you sit at home, what do? Drink more tea. So I'll sit down with that, because I've got a tea girl in here who's my predecessor, the chair of former chair, emeritus chair of KEPSA and KAM, and I think she'll talk about her sector. Thank you very much.
Very good. So actually, without further ado, now that Jazz has introduced, you said, me I hesitate to call her tea girl. I really don't want to call her tea girl. But now that you've been called a tea girl, I want to invite our immediate chair of KEPSA, but the CEO and founder of Melvin International, who specializes in tea, and now we know that you made a lot of money during COVID when everybody. So you tell us how you made and how you're making it sustainable. Karibu sana.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and happy Valentine's. All protocols observed. Yes, it is true, I am known as the tea girl. It's not a bad name, I've accepted. Everybody calls me a tea girl. And I think what I'd like to say is a lot of conversations happen over tea anyway. But what conversations do is they're able to bring together, well, conversations can cause war. I mean, without conversations, you'd have war. But conversations are able to bring people together to share their knowledge and actually succeed in the goals that are happening. So, Mr. Abubakar, it's really great to hear that public and private, I mean, we've always had conversations, but I can see a new zeal where private and public will sit together, because when you're trying to fix something, there's always unintended consequences. And in the positions that I've held in KEPSA and CAM, I've seen, you know, government will say this is how we're going to fix it. And then we come and put on the shoe, and it hurts. So when we have a listening government, it really helps us, because then together we can craft good models and good ideas. So we're happy the tea sector is very resilient and we continue to grow. I think it's the second largest foreign exchange earner. And we hope that it will be able to maintain it. Just this morning, I know I sent him several papers because I know we are going to meet, because we do have a crisis. There's a lot of tea sitting in the auction, prices are going down, and there's a whole conversation that needs to be had. Thank you.
Just before we proceed, Honor of KBX782U, kindly attend to your car urgently. Thank you.
Very good. Before and then, last and certainly not least, because there is a possibility of a serious disagreement with the observations made, because this guy only operates on facts and data, and he leaves emotion at home. Kwame is the CEO of Institute of Economic Affairs, and we'll say a few words. Unfortunately, Kwame, you may not have a choice of the seat to take. Oh, but you can, there are two. So you can choose whichever.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Thanks, I'm honored to be here and I honor everybody. So for that reason, I too hope the protocols are observed. I'll say two things. The first is that it is true that if you sit here on a dispassionate level, it looks like the prospects for the country are better than it was a year ago. Especially because it's clear now that there'll be no default on the Eurobond, which is a good thing. But there's a conversation to be had about its cost. You knew that was coming, right? And then the second point is, because we are speaking here about sustainability, I think on the point of sustainability, especially on the energy side, and generation and consumption of electricity, Kenya is well ahead of the curve. And that's usually a nice thing to note. But it's one thing to be leaders, and as you lead, obviously, that means that you have more opportunities. And the global sustainability challenge is a challenge, but it's also an opportunity for business. So it's one thing to look at more positively. And I think private sector, more than government, is able to actually unpack what the opportunities are, and of course push investments through them. So that's an opportunity for all of us to consider. Thank you.
Ah, very good, and thank you very much for that. Ladies and, it's a lady actually. There's ladies and gentlemen, two ladies and two gentlemen. I'll avoid actually sitting over there. Mi nataka kukaa na wananchi, because I want to hear. I want this to be very very participatory, and I want people to, if you have a question and you're feeling very shy, just come and put it in my pocket or whisper to me and we shall ask. But I want to start by asking the team just to briefly talk about what is your biggest, first of all, what's your view about sustainability? What's the thing you are doing as a person towards sustainability at the personal level, and what do you think the industry that you are in should be doing more to ensure that we create a better future from a sustainability point of view? We shall start with let's start with Jazz.
Thank you, Lance. I think it's a great question, and I think as Kenya, the city is very, very pretty. Right now, our energy mix is 92% green, and our president is very clear by 2030, he wants Kenya to be the first country in the world to be 100% green energy fired. And if you look at all the opportunities that come with it, especially if you're in the export arena and you have a shirt or a suit that's made using green energy, actually it just gives you a competitive advantage. And the cost of going green is not so high. I was telling my team that don't be shocked by 2030, our single largest business in export might be carbon credits and trading carbons as opposed to our traditional goods and services, which right now, as we all know, our number one export is tea. But don't be shocked that carbon trading might be a bigger business than exporting tea. Thank you.
Oh, excellent. So 92% green heading to 100%. Maybe I'll ask Jane, so what?
So definitely the industry has to act. We have to do something because if you look at the analysis of CO2 emissions, for example, when you talk about decarbonization, the industrial sector is contributing 35% of these CO2 emissions, and 31% is coming from buildings and 27% from transportation. So looking at these statistics, then first of all, it gives us clarity on the areas that we need to focus on. And I like when the PS talked about green financing, then we can be strategic about the sector that we need to focus on or the areas that we need to focus on, so that then we can be able to achieve the greatest amount of CO2 emissions reduction. So when you talk decarbonization, you truly have to look at those three areas, and we can get into more details as we move along.
Indeed, we are going to get into more details. Let's go to Flora and understand exactly the same question from agriculture, stroke, manufacturing, sustainability, and what we are doing about it, and what are the gaps, challenges?
I think agriculture and the importance it contributes to this economy, which is 25% to our GDP, is one of the areas that really, really is in dire need of sustainable practices. Of course, climate change being the biggest threat. So I think it is of paramount importance that every single industry, not only the agricultural industry, picks up sustainable practices to ensure that we sort of protect what we would call a quarter of our country's GDP. And this would be on two fronts. Number one, there's a lot of opportunity in this area because of exactly what, you know, globally what is happening. There's a lot of interest, and when there's a lot of interest, there's also a lot of opportunity, there's a lot of money, a lot of funding. So moving away from traditional business models of just rummaging, you know, it's all profits only, let's have a longer term view, and let us take this, let's take advantage of this opportunity. For example, you know, people going into the solar space, not only are they going into the solar space, they're greening, but on top of that, they're doing it in rural areas, which is also helping poverty. So it's high time all businesses started looking at these models, and I'd like to just begin by congratulating DTB. It's a financial institution, but they've actually gone in. It doesn't look as simple as, you know, let's go green, everybody will be a bank, really, but they've understood what is out there. The second point I would say is the importance of doing this is the consumer now is way more aware. The consumer now is not even as interested in as what you're giving them, but that the fact that you care as a business. And there's a lot of them where they can, especially in the Western world, who are willing to pay more. So if, for example, when I'm, you know, sending out my tea, the first question is, it organic? And I say, yes, we have an organic variant, it's slightly more. That is not even a concern. So it will help you on your branding, it would help you on raising more money, which you can then plow back into the country and continue to grow. So there's a lot of opportunity to take advantage of, and secondly, it is the right thing to do. And thirdly, there is demand for it.
Right, and before I go to Kwame, you said, in fact, I think you're addressing the PS, that you have a lot of tea, or there's a lot of tea at the auction.
that is not having a market right now. And now we are talking about sustainability. I believe there are costs associated with sustainability. So you start preaching the gospel of sustainability, and you have even more tea at the auction because you want to. Is it sustainable?
Right now we are suffering. And actually, so yes, there's a lot. I think we produce 550 million tons of tea. There's a lot of it stuck in the auction due to some, several years ago, C.S. Munya actually put a ceiling on the price that can be sold of tea in the auction. Unfortunately, he didn't take into account that teas from the Rift and teas from the Ref, from the East and from the West of the Rift do not sell at the same price. So when you put a ceiling of a tea that the market does not value at that price, it keeps coming back. And that is one of the one of the unintended consequences of trying to alleviate the farmer and give, put more money in his pocket, but we've created another problem. So that is an area that needs to be sorted out. The other one, of course, there's a globally, I think it's high time we went into value addition. And it's a conversation, that's what I was sending him early this morning before I met him, because I had promised. Value addition is a challenge that we have had on the table. I've been in tea for 28 years now. When I started, we were very, very little value-added tea was going outside into the outside the country. I would be, imagine it was like 0.1%. Today, we are at about almost 5% of our teas are going out value-added. But you can see how much opportunity we are losing here. We're sending it out there for other people to blend. Now, there are a myriad of things that need to be done. I don't think this is the forum to actually deal with it.
Yeah.
But we do need to have a conversation with the government and continue to work with them. When we fix one thing, we need to give it space and time to correct it quickly, as opposed to now what has happened. It was a correction 3 years ago or 4 years ago. It has caused yet a bigger problem than what we were trying to solve.
All right. Thank you very much. And Kwame, on sustainability, same question about what we should be doing. But I want you to specifically talk about, because this is business community, there is need for sustainability because it's the right thing to do for Mother Earth. But you being an economist, there must be sustainability that we should be doing and we'll make a lot of besha. Hiyo ni gani? Tusatueleze.
All right. So I think when we think about sustainability, and I say that we are responding to a global warming problem. And if you're going to distribute responsibility for the adverse effects, not everybody is responsible in the same way. And that's why I'm conscious of the fact that Kenya, by using greener sources of energy generation, is going ahead of the curve. So in a way, we are transferring a subsidy to the rest of the world, and that's okay. But remember two things. Let's go to the numbers. The numbers vary, but they're between 100 to 200,000 registered businesses in Kenya, and there are 14 million households. Now, the sustainability opportunity for businesses is something government can support. The sustainability opportunity in households, 14 million of them, with different income levels, constrain their ability to buy and to make those clean solutions immediately. So most rural households still use biomass for cooking. And because government is chasing revenues, raising the prices of kerosene and raising the prices of fuels that people use in cooking, you can bet that the number of people or households, especially at the bottom level, who are going to start using those less sustainable opportunities will rise. So all these things have trade-offs that have to be made. And it's very, very clear, as you saw, last year, for entirely valid reasons, perhaps the messaging wasn't right. The VAT on kerosene came up from 8 to 16%. 50% of the kerosene that was being bought, most of which is used in lighting and illumination in households, especially in rural and poorer households, disappeared. The consumption disappeared. I can tell you those people are not refusing to cook. They're going back and using biomass. So basically, there needs to be connected thinking around these things. So symbolism is not a good thing as policy, but we need to know what trade-offs we make when we decide that we are going to make this decision. Farms and DTB is leading and a few others can't make those decisions. In the office in which I work, people have been worried about what kind of bulbs we use. So in December, we had to do some little refurbishment and we changed all the bulbs to make them. They're a little bit expensive, but farms can afford. But households who are on the edge, and I conclude with the fact that the reason this has to be, I think we have to move at the pace of our people, is because since 2019, I measured this data, some households have not recovered their income levels of 2019 because of COVID shocks. Some of them lost jobs. You know, some people sitting here, you had to let some staff go, and the recovery has not been complete. Last year's taxes and everything. So we just need connected thinking around this place and less than arrogant communication from government that you will take this road or you'll pay for it. Thanks.
These guys don't are very good. I thought they were telling me to shut up by switching off my mic. I want to take that conversation a little forward in terms of sustainability and what we should be doing from Kwame. And I want to talk to maybe the PS. And by the way, the PS is also, though he made the remarks, if you have questions, he's also happy to answer. So I want to say, Bona PS, and I like what you said about KDC, and I know they exist. By the way, I'm a beneficiary of KDC, so I know it works. But looking at Frola and other people in industry, what are those things in terms of sustainability that you are saying, maybe to Kwame's point, that by the way, we are now having those kind of funds that you can begin to think about that not only will advance industry, but will help sustainability. Do we have those mechanisms?
Yes, Chair, we have the mechanism, and the fund is basically whatever we have now. The balance sheet supports all sustainability projects, but we have a specific fund, the one of from World Bank, that now is just focusing on such activities. And to the question from Flora, in terms of value addition, it's correct that it's only 5% of what we produce, and in the Finance Act of 2023, His Excellency the President had introduced two incentives to make sure we increase the value of enhance the value of value addition in the tea sector, which was removing VAT on tea purchase for the purpose of value addition, and removing also VAT on packaging material. And we are seeing that the private sector is responding to that, although there are some challenges in terms of interpretation, and we'll pick it up. In terms of the stock which is yet to be sold, it's because there was a pricing control, and that one was to solve a problem.
Right.
But it looks like it has unintended consequences, so we are going to have a conversation on how to liberalize that price control.
Oh, excellent. And maybe to come, you can see, I don't talk for government, but you can see there is a response, and that's what I like about the PS. We can engage, and we can have responses, and we can disagree and agree. And I think that is how government should operate. So thank you very much, PS. Thank you very much, Kwame. Let us engage, and let us be as honest and transparent and frank as possible, because whether it's government or private sector, you know, when you have a conversation on sustainability, it's about the head game. And the head game is that we want a better society, that we should look back and say, because we existed, look, we created a better society. Now, instead of me just asking the questions, I'm here to give you the mic to directly ask a question that is relevant to the conversation that we're having. Any questions? Noreen, I know you have a question, but I'm on my way to you. Any questions, people? Nassim, you don't have to, I can bring the mic. There we go, thanks. And you say your name? Ask your question.
Thank you. My name is Nirish Shah. This forum is about economic sustainability, and I'm very happy that government is doing a lot, but what we have been discussing more is sustainability in terms of power and agriculture and all. What I'm looking at is we should be having economic sustainability, with the current high interest rates, you know, borrower would be paying anything from 19% to 21%. I mean, I cannot see how business can develop in such a climate. So there has to be something done about the high interest rates. Thank you.
Okay, what I'm hearing is with high interest rates, it's not sustainable. So what are we doing to reduce the interest? I think we had a little bit of that conversation, but did you have any person you wanted to answer the question? Because if you don't, I'll ask both the PS and Kwame to make comments about it, and especially to, I would really appreciate if we also showed the linkage between inflation and interest rates, because oftentimes we say, the banks are charging high interest rates. But I think that education about the relationship between inflation, taming inflation, and interest rate, and that cycle is something that I think we should have a conversation about. Yes.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. My name is Mugwe Manga. I am a representative of the Rockefeller Foundation, and I'm also wearing the hat of a geothermal developer in Kenya. My question is open. There's a lot of good that's happening on the continent and in Kenya. My question is around how can we scale what is happening? How can we have 1,000 tea girls, for example? How can we have more beddy factories? I think the scalability is something that is a cog in seeing real transformation and development. How can we see that accelerate?
I think fantastic question. I didn't know that it was a very popular thing to be a tea girl, because this gentleman would want to see 1,000 of them. But I think on a more serious note, it is how can we scale, whether it is what Jazz does, whether it is what Flora does, whether it is even what DTB does, how can we scale that to many times? And by the way, if we did that, if they're in the thousands, then we would be what people call a developed country. So basically, we are saying, how can we run and start becoming a developed country in this time and age? There was another question here, and then we get them to, there we go.
Thank you so much, Lena. I'm Patrick Nyangweso. I represent Chamber of Commerce. I'm the CEO, but I'm here representing Chamber President. Now, allow me to ask one question and make comments. One of the critical aspects is to build confidence across the globe for our agri products to really meet the global market demand. Flora, you are in this space. Every time we get concerns from exporters, the consumers really want to understand the quality of our products. What is it that the private sector and the government can do to build confidence to improve competitiveness of our export? Then allow me to make this comment. One, I want to appreciate the PS, because this is the first time that the government has given us opportunity as private sector. I happen to sit in that national task force. I want to encourage our players, the private sector players, to give you submit your inputs, especially the pain points, more so on capital financing, taxation regime, the agriculture, the energy sector, so that by the time we are having a round table with His Excellency the President, it is a very comprehensive approach with solid solutions. Thank you.
Okay, very good. Now I'll get to the people to answer. But before I do that, just remind me your name again.
Patrick Nyangweso.
And the question about the question about the private sector is how the private sector can?
And government can work to enhance on competitiveness.
Right. So the CEO of the Chamber, yes, the CEO of the Chamber would want us to discuss how the private sector can work with government to enhance competitiveness. I want to suggest that you are the one who is going to answer that question, because you are the CEO of the Chamber. So I'm going to go around, and then I'm going to come back to you, so that you can answer that question for us. Thank you very much. So we'll start by, because we're on the same side, by the way. This is not government versus what. Here we are people who are want to do business and who want to succeed. Remember, the end game is creating a better society in the ecosystem that you are in. So in that ecosystem, we have to be a human eno. So let us start.
Okay.
Okay. In fact, I think we might start with you, because there's a question by Manga Mogwe on scaling, and Julius wants to make an intervention. Please do.
Julius is an acknowledged Linus, how can you put me on the spot? Okay, on the issue of scaling, I think it is an issue of how we have developed our capital markets. Our capital markets are largely debt-driven, the banks, but we need now to move the scale and say, how do we develop the other stages in the capital formation process? And we need to look at, one, the venture capital market. How do we scale to that level? And then we move to the next one, which is private equity markets. And then now, the IPOs. If we develop that space, and lucky the PS was in CMA, if we develop that space, then people like Flora can then move from using their own personal savings or going for debt to now saying, I can access venture capital funds, I can access PE funds on my way to scaling, and then probably along the way, she does an IPO. If we do that, then we say our capital markets are well developed to scale a business to the level it. And then there's also one last comment, which is there's one gap also that we have in this part of the world, which is angel investors. So that's why a Facebook cannot develop here, but it can develop in America. Elon Musk can be successful in America and not in South Africa where he was born. It's because then there are capital markets that can scale you as you go along. And then the final comment is, for all this to happen, we have to then enhance financial literacy. And that's one of the KPIs probably for MITI, the ministry, which is how can we scale financial literacy then so that people understand how the markets work, and those markets have been developed, and then now everybody scales. If we do that over 20, 30 years, by 2050, Kenya will be a totally different country. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you very much. Maybe on the point of scaling, I'll still ask comments from the floor, but I agree with what you're saying. When you talk about investing, if you look at DTB, many years ago, DTB, Equity Bank, KCB, decided to go public to raise funds in order to expand and become what it was. What it is, one of the problems we have, even in this room, is that hiyo kitu yako, hiyo biashara yako, you wanted to be here. Hiyo ni yetu na my daughter, my son. Then you cannot be a Facebook, because guess what? Even when you said a couple of years back that Bill Gates was the richest person in the world, do you know he was a minority in Microsoft? Do you know that those guys that you say are the richest are minority, because they become minority because they keep raising funds, are out of funds, they keep getting diluted, and in the end, they have a smaller pie of a bigger ocean. But I think we are experts in being 100% owners of a small pod. And we go around saying, that little pod is mine. How many fish does it have? It has 2.5 fish. But it is mine. So maybe there is a mindset thing about how can we create a small chunk of a big ocean. That is what DTB did. If you look at the founder of DTB, he doesn't have 100%. Let Kenyans, let people own and use those funds to expand. That is what Equity did. And if you look at the banking system, it's a good example. Those that did not do that are still very small. Fact. So that, for me, that's the answer. But let's hear from Frola, and let's hear particularly the question on inflation and interest rates from Kwame, and then our chair and Jean. Yes, go ahead.
There you go. I think for me, I want to look at it on two levels, which is the macro level. I will obviously leave macro to Kwame to whatever, but remember, we don't Farms do not operate in a vacuum. We operate in the environment. So the environment that we work in is going to decide also for you whether you would, your ability to scale, you know, more or less to what he's talking about. If cost of finance, interest rates, availability of raw materials, capacity, all that is unavailable from that level, it becomes very, very difficult for a business to survive. In fact, I would actually want to say manufacturers who survive in this environment, and I'm not talking only Kenya, I'm perhaps talking developed countries, tend to do way much, much more than manufacturers in other countries. And I would assume it would be perhaps similar in the service industry. But I know for the manufacturing, your breath has got to go all the way from, you know, from the beginning to the end. And I'll give you a case in point. When I started my tea, I thought, you know, it's very simple. And, you know, I went for an expo in America and they told me, oh, so who packages your tea? How do you drop ship it? How do you get it around? And I was looking and wondering, what are they talking about? Because to start a tea company abroad, you don't even need to see your product. You develop it. You have you develop it. You do the design. You leave it to others. You give distribution to other people. Your work is really to do your marketing and make sure your standards and everything are being maintained by others other than yourself. So here, you tend to have to do everything from making it to producing it to distributing it. I must say, I'm seeing a change. I'm seeing us being able to outsource a lot more these days. And similar to what Chairman is saying, I would encourage that. So for me, it's the micro. The macro has got to be correct, which Kwame will speak about. And the other one is macro. Remember, when we're doing business, we have factors of production. So finance, like we are saying, if my finance costs are high, if they're unavailable, difficult to get, I can't get foreign exchange to import so that I can, my intermediary so I can export, it becomes difficult. We have, we of course have land. We know of large companies that are saying they have insecurity of tenure of their land, you know, after so many years. So that's another thing that doesn't help us. People, the people that we work with, capacity. What is the level of, our literacy level is high, but when we get technical, especially in, again, the more technical we get, the less training and upskilling that we have. There's a lot going on, but it could still be better. And of course, then standardization. Unfortunately for us, we have to succumb to a lot of standards, of global standards when we're trying to export and move our products and services across. So this is a conversation we've had, especially right now with the Africa Continental Free Trade. We're sitting with them and saying, can we not just have one standard for Africa? And easier said than done, because even with Continental Free Trade, if I could give an example, I did get my tea to Ghana under the guided, the GTI, but they've reduced the tariff. This is for you, sir. But they've increased non-tariff barriers. So they would open a packet of tea and check the millimeters and the centimeters, and they say, this color is different from, you know, down to a very, very specific level. And I'm like, listen, my tea's in the US, in the UK. They don't care. So I think there's a whole conversation that need to be had around standards if we really want to support ourselves.
Yep.
I wonder why we want to do it to ourselves, but anyway. So those are
very
my
good
answers.
Let's hear Kwame in terms of that question asked about the economics of inflation and the lending rates, because I suspect the gentleman asking that question is saying, why can't DTB lend us at 5%? Please, let's look at the ecosystem and what drives what obtains in the market.
Okay, I'll hijack the dispensation to answer two questions. The first one is on scaling, and then I'll answer about the interest rates.
Go ahead.
The scaling one is very, very important because, the scaling one is very, very important because at the Institute of Economic Affairs, we looked at the last few years, and we realized that it wasn't actually true that manufacturing exports were not going up. They were just not going up as fast as GDP was growing. And so we asked ourselves why, and I found out something that I've always considered very interesting. We at the IEA wanted to find out what is the single farm, not sector, such as agriculture or tea, that earns Kenya the highest foreign exchange. And we found out that there are two. One is Tata Magadi Soda Company, which is based in Magadi, and the other was Tiomin, the other one. As a single farm, I'm not talking about sector, but sector T is definitely much larger. And so I visited the place, And the point I was asking is, Kenya produces the excuse me, Kenya produces the highest quality of table salt and the highest quality of soda ash globally. And because I was an old student of chemistry, I asked myself, soda ash is not a consumable in its own. It's used in making glass, it's used in making detergents and soap and paper. Why aren't those industries here? Because we have this value addition argument. And what I found is a glass company requires so much energy and the supply has to be uninterrupted. Uninterrupted for an 18-hour cycle. So if there's 1 minute of interruption, all that silicon and everything is wasted. And that's not available here. So that's one. So what Magadi Soda Ash does is, they cannot have a glass company next door, even if it would be a tremendous advantage in value addition. So what these things tell you about the possibility of scaling are undermined by our own domestic regulatory environment. So we have homework to do there. The soda ash is exported to Thailand and to Dubai, then soap is made in Dubai, in the UAE, because they import the best soda ash and then they use it to make the soap, detergents and everything other things. So there's a lot of homework for us to do domestically here. So the scaling argument can actually be resolved back down. Coming to interest rates, I think, yes, the central bank is responding to the fact that there's elevated inflation. Inflation was driven by many things, including the fact that food prices, for the last 5 years before the last one, Kenya has had below average rainfall. That drives the prices of food up. The Kenya shilling was depreciating. That has created the prices of fuel to go up. So that was really driving. So we understand that. That has a knock-on effect on how banks can lend, how much banks can lend. So we are caught in this environment in which government has to respond in reducing inflation, or the central bank has to respond in reducing inflation. That has an knock-on effect on what banks can lend, and then obviously it raises the income. And if government is borrowing money, 91 days treasury bonds at 15-16%, why would a bank lend to me at 15? I mean, if they can take 16% from government for 90 days, why would they lend to me? So there's something structurally about that, and that's why I can't wait for inflation and the Federal Reserve Bank in the US to respond in a way that actually begins to do this. But here, I think we are caught with this problem for the next 6 months or so. So it's not the fault of a bank. In fact, I know many banks, for those who have mortgages, have had to have a conversation to increase the tenure of payment, because otherwise defaults would be over the roof. I mean,
excellent. Thank you very much. So, umeona sio DTB. Hiyo kitu ni global. And as we watch inflation, and even the inflation factor is not necessarily domestic. Yes, there's food prices and all that, but there's a global component. Like you said, even what is happening in the US and other markets has implications in this domestic market. I'll go to Jazz, and Jazz, same question about expanding. You are even in several markets. And then for Jane, I'll ask, because I really do not want us to lose this theme of sustainability. What are the things that you would, because, and Babuli is quite on the forefront of this exercise.
Looking at the drivers of competitiveness. And I think the next couple of years as the chair of KDM, our strategic plan is simple. We need to look at our global competitiveness. Because if you're not competitive, if you're not world class, you're really no class. And that is clear. You want to be world class or you're no class. And I think we really want to be world class. And there are only five drivers of competitiveness. And your number one driver of competitiveness is your bill of materials, which is your BOM. And on bill of materials, by and large, every industry in this country is buying at world price. So there's no competitive disadvantage on our bill of materials. Okay. The other four drivers of competitiveness are where we need to do some work. One is, the second one is utilities. And in utilities, I mean cost of power, cost of electricity, you know, all utilities of production. We need to address that. We cannot be working the way we are in uncertainty and not knowing what our price of utilities are going to be. Three is productivity. I don't want to use the word labor because labor is very subjective. I've already told you our labor is $100 a month today. Very, very cheap compared to the rest of the world. In fact, it's lower than Bangladesh. But we're not productive as a country because we don't have a productive index. Productivity is a very different discussion as opposed to cost of labor.
Right.
I think we need to overhaul our labor laws. We need to look at things differently. We need to be paying on unit cost of production and not on somebody sitting on a chair and you take the box, yes, you spend 8 hours in the office, he needs to be paid for 8 hours. No, we need to move away from hours paid to units produced. And of course, the next one is logistics. For every four containers that make their way into Kenya, we export one container. So three containers out of Nairobi will make their way empty to Mombasa. So it tells you a story. It tells you that we are importing a lot more than exporting. Surely, as government, we need to look at if those three containers are going back with zero cost or zero revenue, maybe those three containers can go back at a token fee of $200 a box. And that could be your logistics cost going back. That means you start pushing your economy into export because the price comes down as opposed to $800 a box for one container out of four. And then lastly is finance, interest rates, cost of finance, tenor of finance. Our entire financial sector needs an overall. We can't be doing our entire business on short-term bonds and expect long-term loans. It's just not possible.
Mm.
We need to change the way we, our financial architecture needs to change. There needs to be long-term loans, long-term bonds. It cannot be that you are lending on short-term because your money is also tied to short-term.
Mm.
There's a whole discussion around tenor and cost. Tenor is a problem, cost is a problem, and we cannot operate in the current environment of 18, 20, 25% purely because of the dynamics I've already talked about, but there are really serious issues to address. And I would just like to close by saying, yes, Kenya will be world-class, and Kenya can be world-class, and we need to really move away from the current narrative and break away from today's reality.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Jas, for that. Let's hear Jane. Jane, I really want you to look at these guys on their eyes and talk sustainability and what we leave this door thinking about doing that will help to change Mother Earth.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. So I know there's this perception that sustainability is expensive to implement and there's no payback, or the payback is too long, to, and therefore people shy away, or organizations shy away. So what I will do today, I will share with you practical examples of things that we have implemented as Bamburi Cement in sustainability, and I can be able to show you the cost benefit. Then you can take a pick, because I'll give you several examples. And I'll start on the topic that I'm very passionate about, on decarbonization, because I shared the statistics earlier where 35% of the world CO2 emissions are coming from the manufacturing industry. And when you take that 35% and then break it down further, 25% of that is from steel manufacturers and 19% is coming from the cement industry. So for us, decarbonization is not a luxury. It's something that we have to do to save Mother Earth, as the chair has said. So, and I'll tell you, and it's also a call to action, and I'm happy that the PS is here. It's also a call to action to also our competitors, because when we do it together,
and everybody in the sector does it, then you can imagine the impact, considering the statistics we just shared. So when we talk about decarbonization, one of the things that we have to do is reduction of clinker factor. So one of our raw materials in production of cement is clinker, and in the production of clinker, there's high CO2 emissions. Now, when you use less clinker in the cement production without interfering with the quality of the cement, maintain the quality of the cement, but add other additives that are able to give the cement the same qualities, then you're able to reduce your CO2 emissions, but have direct savings, because less clinker used equals money saved. So, and this is something we can be able to demonstrate and we have been able to achieve over the years. Another thing that we do very proudly is use of alternative fuels. In the manufacturing of cement, again, the clinkerization process and also cement process, there's use of, and many other industry, manufacturing industries, are also using a lot of what we call fossil fuels. So that would be coal, it can be heavy fuel oil. I know lots of companies are using that diesel for powering their boilers and all that. And we are shifting from that and using what we call alternative fuels or biomasses, if you like. You can use biomass for that matter. And I'm happy to report that, like in our Nairobi plant, we have two operations, one in Nairobi, one in Mombasa. In our Nairobi plant, we are doing about 95% on average substitution, where we are not using, we're only using on very rare occasions, because currently we are also doing, in some months we have been able to achieve 100% where we are not using any fossil fuel. And in Mombasa, we are also scaling up. Of course, it requires a lot of investment, and it requires a lot of commitment, because it interferes with operations, but we are a committed company in sustainability, and we are saying we are going for it. So we have seen, again, by use of these alternative fuels, not only is it saving the CO2 emissions, but it's also saving us money, because the cost of biomass, frankly speaking, you cannot equate it to the cost of HFO, for example. The savings are massive. So that's also an area where even the young guys, and I'll give you a small example of a few weeks ago, I visited a young man in his go-downs in Thika, and he was showing me his operations. He doesn't understand it from the sustainability perspective, but when I looked at it, I said, wow, this guy is implementing circular economy without even knowing it. So he operates with the macadamia factories. So what he does, he goes and collects their waste. So they have the nuts that are off-spec that they cannot be able to package, so he takes that at a small price, and then he takes away the shell, the macadamia shells. So what he does with the nuts is he squeezes out, he has a small extraction machine, so he squeezes out the oil. He has some guys in the cosmetic industry who come and take up that oil at a small fee, at a fee of course. Then the cake that comes out of this squeezing of this macadamia cake, berry, and he squeezes out the oil. What remains, which is what they call the macadamia cake, he uses it to make animal feed. So he has a chicken feed, a small establishment that he generates income from. And then the shells, he has a small crusher. So he crushes the shells and then takes them, the crushed material, through a sieve. Again, a juakali sieve. Whatever goes through the sieve, a 2 millimeter sieve, whatever goes through, there's a Chinese who buys that and makes organic fertilizer. And whatever remains on top of the sieve is then sold to companies like us to be used as biomass. So this is supposed to be waste coming from the macadamia industry, but he has been able to transform that into 4 products that are usable and that are bringing economic value into the country. So when you talk about scalability, then how can we think out of the box and be able to influence more young people to be able, and even other people in the industry, to be able to go big on this, because he's just doing this from like a small warehouse. So you can imagine if it's being done in a large scale. And we have many, and I have a friend here from the agricultural sector, many other people in the agricultural sector, we have waste, they have waste, but they don't know how to use it. The avocado sector, for example, is one of them. I was interacting with some of the manufacturers, and once they squeeze out the oil from the avocado, they don't know what to do with that pulp. But if that pulp is dried, then it can be a source of biomass because then it will be usable in the industry. But they don't have the capacity today. So when you're talking about the green financing, then probably these are some of the areas that we can be able to tap into. I know solar energy, for example, it's been talked a lot about. It will reduce, of course, the scope 2. The ones that I've spoken about are mostly on the scope 1 emissions, CO2 emissions, which are more on the manufacturing side. And then when you go to the solar side, in Kenya, and I like that my friend here talked about it, that in Kenya today, the KenGen has been able, in fact, I think we are number 6 in the world, if I'm not wrong, happy to be corrected, in terms of having green electrical energy because of the generation, the power generation mode that we are using. So our electricity is more than 90% green. So mostly when we implement solar projects, it's not more to save on the CO2 emissions on scope 2, but it's a cost saving. I can tell you for Bamburi, we are doing a 20 megawatts solar plant, part of it in Nairobi, 5.5 in Nairobi and 14.5 in Mombasa. It's a PPA, that means we don't need to put in any investment, and therefore we will be getting about, give or take, 400 million savings every year on power. They're going to take away 30% of our power load. So I can go on and on. I have thousands of examples, but before I hand over the mic to the chair, if you have not visited our iconic Hala Park in Mombasa, this is also a great example of Bamburi story on sustainability, where all the land that we mine, 100%, and this is part of our commitment again to sustainability, 100% of the land that we mine, we have rehabilitated. And Hala Park in Mombasa is one example of such, where we've planted trees, put in animals, of course, in collaboration with KWS, and we have won many global awards on this work, and we are earning revenue. So thank you very much, and
so.
Happy to welcome
you. Sasa Jane, thank you. Thank you very much. Guys, they are doing 20 megawatts, and you know that sounds like vocabulary. Let me put it in layman terms. 20 megawatts is enough electricity to power Kajiado, the whole of Kajiado. So it's we are talking big stuff here. 20 megawatts by one company towards sustainability is a really huge initiative. Thank you very much. Because time is much spent, I will ask our PS to respond to some of those issues, maybe make final comments so that we can move to the next item. And thank you very much for being patient with this conversation and participating. That is much appreciated. Asante sana.
All right. Thank you very much, Chair. Yes, we have taken note that we need a strategic shift on our strategic focus from ease of doing business to cost of doing business, and that is why the cabinet approved that that committee, which is currently we are engaging the private sector to identify those cost issues which are going to be transformational for the president to intervene. We just want to be specific on like 3 major costs in each sector, so that His Excellency the President can intervene. And what we are getting so far is that 3 major costs are emerging, is cost of capital, cost of taxation, and cost of energy. So on the cost of capital, the conversation we are having is whether we can be having a framework for blended finance and de-risking mechanism. But in terms of the interest rate, why we are raising the interest rate, I think that's a global issue. All the central banks globally, they are raising their interest rate to manage the inflation and the exchange rate. And the subject matter expert, I think, has agreed that that is the only way to manage inflation, unless there's another way to do it. It's just you need to increase it's a monetary policy tool to manage the inflation rate. However, with respect to crowding out private sector, that we are going there, we are borrowing at, you are the guys who are quoting the price. We don't go out there and say we are issuing a bond at 20 or at 18. It is the market which is telling us that we can only give you money at this rate. So for us to ease that pressure of going to borrowing, We need to, you know, increase our productivity so that we can raise more taxes. You guys are saying the taxes we are, it's harming you. All right, then if taxes are harming you, then let us at least sell what we want and it is what we have, and it is not strategic or it is not profitable through privatization. You guys are going to court to stop privatization. Then we are like, okay, then let's do PPP, at least concessions, so that we don't go to borrow. You guys are going to court. You don't want us to do concession with the ports. Now we had said, when you are in a hole, we stop digging. But now the hole is digging itself, because you are pushing us to the borrowing space, and it is the market which determines the rate anyway. On how to scale, there are three ways. When something goes down, people always say, when companies go down, I had that experience in the receivership and liquidation world under the leadership of my madam here. People say there is lack of money, that's why I'm going down, or the product we are producing, they are not competitive, or there is no market for our product. So what the government is doing is diversifying the funding space, the way you have put it, from angel to VC to private equity to the banking sector and deepening our capital markets. And also, in terms of competitiveness, we are incentivizing so that you guys can be competitive. But you have to prove to us that in this sector, if you incentivize it, it will be more productive. Otherwise, we are just racing to the bottom. And the third way of increasing our market, we are signing economic partnership agreement with Europe so that we can have more market. We have with UK, and we are continuing. I think this year we're going to sign another economic partnership agreement, the comprehensive one with UAE, so that we can increase your market so that you can scale. On the quality of our products, we are currently having a conversation with Afreximbank to construct Africa Quality Assurance Center at Kipevu EPZ, which is near the port, to help us in assessing the quality of our product. Our goal is to have the competitiveness of Asia and quality of Europe. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mark. Yes. And now I think we come to the end of this conversation. I want to take the opportunity to thank these good practitioners for having such a rich conversation, and to thank you, the audience, for being participatory and also being patient. So tuwapigie makosi, asante sana kwa kuja. And we hope when we invite you again, you'll come so that this conversation can stay alive, because it's an important conversation about ourselves and our businesses. Over to you, Faith.
Thank you so much, our speakers and our moderator, for elevating the conversations today. I think there's a lot of insights that many of us will take home from this engagement today. In the interest of time, allow me to invite to the podium Mr. Amrish Shah, who will make some remarks about the EDGE certification and present the same to the leadership of DTB. Thanks.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Amrish Shah. I'm the principal of Urban Green Consultants. We're a leading green building consulting firm in East Africa. We've been engaged in over 60 green building projects, mostly in Kenya, but also 9 other African countries. So we're very excited to see the green building movement taking off, the uptake from developers and architects happening in the country and the wider region. It's an honor to be here today to celebrate a significant achievement by DTB, the attainment of IFC EDGE certification for the headquarters of Mombasa, Mombasa Road. This recognition is not just a milestone for the bank, but a testament to their commitment to sustainability and environmental stewardship. IFC EDGE, which stands for Excellence in Design for Greater Efficiencies, is a green building certification system developed by the IFC, a member of the World Bank, focused on making buildings more resource efficient. EDGE was developed to ensure that buildings are designed, constructed to reduce water and energy use, reduce global emissions, and make a more positive impact on the environment. Achieving EDGE certification requires meeting strict criteria in these areas in order to quantify and demonstrate a project's sustainability performance. So how did DTV achieve this? Though the building was constructed over 10 years ago, some of the original building design, formation, and geometry helped put the building on a path to high performance. However, more significantly, DTB, with the help of a very strong facility management team, I'd like to point out the facility management team, Faisal, please, because Faisal did an amazing job on this building. Thank you, Faisal. Took numerous strides to improve the energy, water, and thermal comfort performance of the building. Urban Green consultants were brought on to assess and analyze the building performance against the EDGE tool, and after the implementation of the various measures, such as improved lighting fixtures, controls, solar PV, water efficiency measures, the project was able to meet the EDGE standard. Not only was the building able to achieve the minimum threshold, it also excelled to achieve EDGE Advanced certification, which is awarded to projects that achieve over 40% against the energy threshold on EDGE. DTB headquarters achieved 62% energy efficiency, which is one of the highest in the region, and puts the building on the pathway to being able to achieve net zero carbon by 2030, which can be applied when future upgrades are made. And we'll discuss a lot more with Faisal and the team on how we can get DTB to meet net zero carbon and could be the first building to achieve net zero carbon in the country, the region, and one of the first on the continent. Climate change and meet increasing regulatory demands. Achieving EDGE certification is a clear demonstration of DTB's commitment to sustainability, setting an example for the industry and contributing to a more sustainable future. This achievement aligns with the growing demand from investors, customers, and stakeholders to act responsibly and sustainably. It was a privilege to work alongside DTB on this project, and I look forward to seeing how their leadership continues to inspire others towards a sustainable future. Thank you, and I'd like to invite the group CEO, Nazim, to come and accept the award.
Faisal. Where would you like to do the photo?
Karim Jiwa, thank you very much. It's your energy, your passion that's really taken us to this. So you should have been on the stage as well. But be that as it may, a director of strategy and finance has been leading this. Another person who I would like to acknowledge in one second is Jamie Loden. The facilities department reporting to Jamie. Jamie's our chief operating officer. And so between Al-Karim and Jamie, and this guy who has endless energy. He gets calls from me at 12 o'clock. I've never had a pleasant call with him because I only call him when we have problems and or there are issues. So today, it's my time to pay back to you. Thank you, Faisal. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Amrish, and congratulations to DTB for that.
Allow me then to invite our finance director, Mr. Al-Karim Jiwa, to make the closing remarks.
Good morning, everybody. I was looking at my watch because I was wondering, I mean, the time's gone fast, but it's been quite deep, and I was wondering whether we had passed the noon point and whether I should start with a morning or an afternoon. But I'm sure you all agree with me. The last roughly 2.5 hours have been absolutely splendid. Yes? Yeah? And this is thanks to the awesome speakers we've had, led by our chief guest and our keynote speaker, P.S. Abubakar Asantesana. This is the third edition of our Economic and Sustainability Forum. We had two last year. And what I would like to emphasize is that in designing and running these forums, we are very intentional about making sure that they are not just thought leadership sessions for you, our customers and our partners. They are meant to be calls for action. And we hope that as you perhaps applaud and appreciate sessions like this, the greatest tribute you could pay to such forums is to then taking some action from the gems that we have heard of, the use cases that have been spoken about this morning. So we look forward to you to take this forward in your own organizations. And because these matters turn on sustainability, to quote our chairman, also in your own personal lives, there are several calls to action that we hope that you're inspired by and that you will take to action going forward. I want to once again acknowledge P.S. Abubakar for the very engaging session, for being responsive to some of the questions and issues that were raised, and to all of our panelists. They've done an absolutely wonderful job. Don't you agree? Yeah? Thank you. Naseem kicked it off by reminding us to look at the bigger picture. And she emphasized that the proverbial glass is more than half full. But perhaps we'll change it today. We'll start calling it the cup of tea. And I think we should take it that the cup of tea is more than half full. Faith, you topped up that proverbial cup of tea by talking to us that as inflation and the FX spectrum stabilizes, that should drive up a more positive and sustained sentiment going forward. And that as a consequence, I'm sure it's music to the ears of many in this room, we should see interest rates taking a curve and taking a downward trajectory in the coming months. And as that happens, and we follow that sustained downward projectile in interest rates, that should be one of the reasons that the economy will begin to open up and to grow, and that we will see some real growth coming through, inshallah, from the second half of the year. Chairman Linus reminded us today that sustainability is more than a business conversation. It's about our values. It's about all of us as joint stakeholders and custodians of Mother Earth. And he told us, sustainability is not just business, it's personal. Thank you. It was great to hear, P.S. Abubakar, that Kenya continues to score a number of firsts. 29th fastest growing economy, first in Africa in setting up startups. That's something to feel proud of. He also talked about the five tools which are meant to promote an enabling environment, the SEZs, the EPZs, the business reform, and doing and business transformation unit, the de-risking tool, So some key takeaways for us. And we talked not just about the ease of doing business, but we also learned about the cost of doing business. Jess spoke to that, and we look forward to some of the initiatives that the ministry is going to take and is promoting. Our ears pricked up at DTB when you spoke to the fact that you're looking at greening investments. And as an intermediary, Bona PS, we are looking at partnering with you in your agenda to greening investments, because we have an agenda to green finance some of these investments. The key takeaway for us is that we should not, as we tend to do, overestimate the risks and underestimate the opportunities that lie before us. From our panelists, some great gems. Flora, you talked to us about how we need to convert our business models to go green, and that we should work with the consumer as we go green before the consumer walks away from us for not being green enough. P.S. Abubakar, you talked about funds from the World Bank, which are going to be devoted to greening. That pricked our ears again as financial intermediaries, and we will definitely be engaging with you to see how we can partner with you to access those funds and provide it to our audience here and to our banking customers generally across Kenya. Some great conversations around how to accelerate scalability, and the responses came actually not just from the panelists, but from the floor. Julius spoke to how we should use capital markets and financial markets to scale up. Flora spoke about some new and emerging issues. Insecurity of tenure, that's a new one for me, but a very real issue. The war for talent, it is something that is top of mind for most business executives in Kenya and around the world. Kwame, thank you to you as well for reminding us about some of the structural issues that that are facing us. Some are, yes, imported. They are global in nature, but some are domestic. And perhaps if we fine-tune a little bit, you know, we can go a long way to get to sustainable growth as we reinvent our businesses. Jess, some great conversations you spurred around how do we become a world-class business to sustain and build on competitiveness. You talked about bills of materials, the cost of utilities, and thinking of the cost of labor beyond the cost of labor, and thinking about our productivity indices. So not how many hours our people have put in our organizations, but how much have they got out, how much have they contributed to in terms of output. Jane, you definitely destroyed the myth that sustainability is a cost of doing business and that it has no payback or low payback. It was great to hear some of the use cases that Bamburi has been promoting and has experienced over the years. Heller Park is a great example. A lot of us who were young parents or are young parents will totally relate to how impactful Bamburi has been over the decades in promoting the sustainability agenda. So, asante sana to all the panelists. In ending, I would like to just pay tribute to Naseem Devji once again for giving us the space and, yes, the budget to hold forums like this. I hope we delivered on the ROI. And again, to our chairman, because he challenged us this time to say he's attended these forums before, but he wants it in his quest to make sure that we live up to our value of excellence, that we elevate it several notches higher. We'll leave it to him to judge whether we have lived up to his expectations. I'm sure, if you know Linus well, he's not short of giving feedback, both positive, which we hope and quest for, as well as areas where we could improve. As we close, I would like the following people to stand up. I would like Faith Atiti to stand up. I would like Ann Nderi. She in the room? Ann. I would like Asmaira Thobani. Yeah. To stand up. Faith, as you know, is our head of research. Ann, who was here earlier, is our head of sustainability. Asmaira is head of our corporate communications. As they say, behind every seemingly looking successful man is a woman. In my case, I have at least three ladies. They all support me in the different areas that they lead. And today, a tribute to them and to the teams that they lead in making today's event a success. I would also like Alvin Makoya, if he's in the room, to rise. He was here earlier. Alvin's our head of marketing. And he, together with our partners, Evensis, are responsible for putting the show together today from a marketing point of view. And our thanks also to the Oxygen PR team, who are partners in public relations. So that's all, folks. We look forward to seeing you again during our next forum, which we plan to hold perhaps after the budget is read. We've not decided on the theme yet. We wanted to avoid the whole conversation around techs because we felt that's a pretty saturated area these days. But let's see how that goes as we move forward. Before closing, I would just like to call upon Naseem to come to the stage one more time. We just want to honor our panelists. And as she does that, can I just say that if you felt that today's event was a match of the day for you, then can we please recognize the best player of the match, who was our moderator for the panelists, Linus Gitahi, Asante Sana. So, Chairman Linus, if you could also join us, if you could also join us on the stage. We just want to honor. Yes. Wow. So, Faith, can we start by honorating our moderator first? And we will ask Naseem to just give him a token of our appreciation for being the player of the day. Yeah. And if we may ask Flora also to come forward, as well as Jane, followed by Jess and Kwame. Thank you. I think the next time we think about a tea girl, we'll definitely have a different definition and a view about the tea girl. Yeah?
I think it'll be five times.
Jane, thank you for letting us know that red is the new green. Or is it green that's the new red? Thank you. Thank you, Jess.
Thank you. It's a hard time to Shazad.
Kwame Asante Sana, thank you very much. All right, thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Wishing you a good day ahead. Oh, there's one more. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. P.S. Abubakar, my apologies. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you, Naseem. All right. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and we hope to see you at the next one. Thank you very much. Goodbye.
place where people consult, where people relax, where people talk about business opportunities, but it's a place where two brains come together, the bank brain and the customer's brain, and they look at opportunities and how we can do business together.